Hi, thank you for joining us. Hope you just had a chance to see new Bears coach Marc Trestman answer the media's questions after a rather lengthy introduction with a little bit of ham thrown in from Bears general manager Phil Emery. It is the 14th stop on Marc Trestman's career that makes him the 14th head coach in the history of the Chicago Bears franchise. Along those times in his previous jobs, he's been a quarterback's coach 10 times, and that perhaps bodes well. Or not, we'll see, but certainly he made very clear today he'll be very involved in the development of Jay Cutler going forward, including calling the plays, being involved in those meetings, but he said this would not necessarily take away from any of his work in the rest of his job as head coach. He still has a lot to do with his staff. He's made two hires. We know now that Rod Marinelli will not be coming back, so the Bears are looking for a defensive coordinator. If you're interested, you can apply to Hallis Hall and Lake Forest. Sounds like he's got some other candidates there for other jobs as well. Some are coming down from Canada to join him. I am joined right now, by the way, I should have said, my name is Mike Kellams. I work here at the Tribune. I'm joined by my two pals, Vaughn McClure and Steve Rosenbloom. We'll be joined later on the phone by Matt Bowen and David Haugh, who is at Hallis Hall today. So an hour long of what I heard were a lot of great questions, according to the Bears. That's what we do here in the media in Chicago. We ask great questions and see if we have any great answers. Steve, we'll start with you. Just your overall impressions. What did you hear today? What do you think of the guy?
I like the fact that he was willing to, there seemed to be more transparency. I didn't like the idea that he hadn't seen the Bears play. Mm-hmm. I mean, didn't you, you've asked coaches questions, the coach questions, and I've listened to these answers, and I wondered how he got the job if he couldn't comment on these specific players. It was pretty clear that Phil Emery was going to look for a guy who could make this Bears football team successful. And several times, Marc Trestman said, I don't know enough to tell you how about that. Whether it was the scheme of the defense. Brandon Marshall. Brandon Marshall had a lot of numbers. I haven't seen him play. Really? And it was very telling that
he said he was open a lot.
He was open a lot, and that's wrong. He was not.
He wasn't quite open a lot.
Jay Cutler threw to him anyways.
Right, a lot.
Into triple teams.
Right.
And here's something else. He wouldn't commit the way Phil Emery did that Jay Cutler was a franchise quarterback. That was very notable, very noticeable, because Emery's words were thrown up to his coach, and they were talking about being in lockstep, which I understand the efficiency of being in lockstep. I have a problem with that. Being an argumentative sort myself.
What?
There needs to be some counter, right? Some give and take. You don't want the Stepford administration down there.
And you don't, on the question of Cutler, you don't think you heard that then?
He didn't say that.
But he didn't say Cutler is a franchise quarterback.
He said he loves football.
Right.
And he said that he's looking to get better.
Absolutely. But he didn't say he's a franchise quarterback, which I took, frankly, as a positive sign that the new coach
doesn't believe that he's there yet.
Well, isn't convinced, and Jay Cutler has some work to do with the new guy with a year to go on his deal.
Yeah, because you know what? You got to look at it too. He's dealt with some franchise quarterbacks. Steve Young, maybe Rich Gannon was not a household name, he still was an MVP. You know, I mean, he's dealt with some guys. He's been with the highest level quarterbacks. So, yeah, maybe he is looking at this and saying, hey, you know what? This guy hasn't accomplished some of the things that some of the other guys I work with in the past have accomplished. So, yeah, he's got to take some steps. He's got to take some strides before I can put him up in that category of a franchise guy.
But he did place the importance on Cutler. Everything starts with the quarterback. He characterized that relationship as the strongest and the most important relationship in sports. Frankly, I think Tony La Russa and Dave Duncan is the most important relationship in sports. Barry Bonds and a syringe is the most important. Anyways, the idea that he looked at it, he placed that importance on the quarterback, wouldn't declare him a franchise quarterback, could be interpreted, if Jay's pouty face wants to come out, as a guy who's now on notice. Because the general manager didn't bring Cutler in. He didn't trade for him. That was another general manager. The coach was brought in by the general manager, and it's like a one-year free look. It's a one-year evaluation. Do we want to pay this guy money? I know they can franchise him, right? They have actually 2 years of franchise tag. However, Jay Cutler should be on notice more than at any other time, I think, in a professional career for quarterbacks who are used to getting coddled and right.
I totally agree with you, Steve. Now I do believe that Jay has tremendous talent. Okay,
physically, yeah, no question.
He does. I mean, some of the things we saw him even running the ball, running, you know, scrambling for extra yards at the end of the year, I thought was pretty phenomenal. And with this West Coast offense and this scheme, he's going to be moving the pocket. He's going to be doing different things, but that leadership is still the question. I mean, you know, from people that I've heard and talked to, the leadership really took a tailspin at the end of the season last year. I mean, this past season. And that's not a good thing. It should be going up. Mm-hmm. Everything should be going up for him in terms of being a leader and getting along with his teammates. So that's the thing that he has to work on. And I think if he works on those kind of things and works with Trestman and gets better with some of the let me tell you something else. I talked to Anthony Caviglio, who was the quarterback
up in Montreal. Mm-hmm.
He had great success, and I think he's like the passing leader in pro football history.
He has like 78,000 yards.
Ridiculous. But he told
even me, Canadian, that's a lot of yards.
But he told me yesterday that Coach Trestman, when he came in to Montreal, he took his game to another level.
So well, I saw you tweet the number, just the number of plays involved, right?
Right.
Which was significant.
Double the plays.
I don't think Jay Cutler's a bad learner. And I think, I've never sensed that he's a bad student. Mm-hmm. He sounds like a guy who's a good student. You're up, you have a greater chance of seeing that. It's not like you see Devin Hester and somebody's got to lift him up and put him in the right place.
Right.
And by the way, I'm glad there was no Hester question. I don't want him to be part of the offense. I don't think he'll be able to handle it if you're talking about the kind of plays.
That's right.
I think Jay can handle that. Mm-hmm. He's always had to... It's almost as though he's had to be convinced to buy in to somebody else's deal. Mm-hmm. But now I think that the accomplishments of the quarterbacks, if he is the quarterback whisperer, if that's what Marc Trestman is, and you go from Steve Young and all those nice words he said to Rich Gannon and MVP, and you know who is left off the list a lot? Scott Mitchell.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Left-handed
and
ungainly. And he had his best year
made him good.
With him. Mm-hmm.
Let's, you know, an interesting thing. Normally when we do this little powwow here, we're trying to figure out who won the game. today, you heard Marc Trestman talk a lot about winning the day. It's one of his philosophies as he goes through his day. It's reflected in how he practices. He made that clear. That's part of his fundamentals is, can we win the day? We now are joined on the phone by Matt Bowen. A player who I think our Tribune readers know well as a writer, contributor, 7-year NFL veteran. Matt, today, thank you for joining us. Are you there?
I am. What's going on, guys?
Well, I think a little bit's going on. You know, from what you heard out of Marc Trestman today, if you were on that Bears roster, did he win the day with you? What did you make of it?
You know what he reminded me of, guys, and it's not the same coach, but that reminded me of sitting in the team meeting room with Dick Geron in Buffalo. There's a lot of coach speak, a lot of straightforward business-like approach, that same monotone tone throughout the whole speech. That's a lot of coach speak. If I'm a player, it didn't tell me a lot, but I will say this. The one thing that you take from that as a player is that he's going to make a lot of decisions on that roster. He didn't give away anything. He played everything close to the vest. But you know he's watched tape on those guys. You know he's prepared to make some moves. You know that was discussed when he was hired with Phil Emery is about this current roster. And he has an idea already of what moves he's going to make, who he's going to let go, what they're going to look for in free agency, what they're going to look for in the draft. So if you're a player, probably just more questions, really. Probably just more wondering, am I going to be around next year?
Matt, I totally agree. So you definitely think he watched more film than a couple clips.
yeah. He's not. He wasn't looking at highlights on YouTube or anything. That guy was in the film room. That's what he was doing. He was analyzing that roster, deciding what he wants to do, and that's part of the assistant coaches he's going to hire. Part of what he's going to do on the defensive side of the ball. Mm-hmm. If he wants to go to a 3-4, he has to know what the personnel he's working with and who he's going to make for that hire. So, yeah, he knows this whole roster. I thought he, you know, like I said, very businesslike, not giving anything away. That was a lot of coach speak that can be recycled anywhere.
So why would he say that? Why would he come off as I asked the question, how do you get the job if you haven't looked at the – if you can't break down players, if you can't break down plays, if you can't break down units –
I don't think he wanted to give anything away to the media. I really don't. Mm-hmm. I think he wants to keep this
media's not
in-house.
So we really aren't his friend. So he lied.
Yeah.
What's he been reading, the Notre Dame handbook?
Oh, gosh. But I'll tell you what, he knows what he wants to do. Any coach would. If it was Bruce Arians, he would have known what he wanted to do as well. If it was Coach Bevel, same thing. They know what they're getting into. They know what they have at the quarterback position, where they need to upgrade, what they need to do at the tight end position along the offensive line. Those are all key questions that need to be answered throughout the offseason and through the draft and free agency.
I just want to ask, if you were to base it simply on what you heard Marc Trestman say today, is Jay Cutler on notice because the coach refused to go along with the general manager in labeling him a franchise quarterback?
Well, I think Jay should be on notice with not depending on what Marc Trestman said, but just knowing that there's a new coach in town. He has to understand that he's going to be evaluated every single day. And there's no guarantee he's going to get a new contract. There's no guarantee he's going to be here the rest of his career. He has a lot to prove. And as I wrote in the Tribune this morning, he needs to be coached up hard. He needs to be tested. He needs to be pushed. And Marc Trestman has to find out if this is the quarterback he's going to build the future of his team around.
Matt, one of the things I was telling the guys, I was talking to the CFL quarterback, Cavillo, yesterday. One of the things he talked about with Coach Trestman was he never had to study as much as he did when Marc Trestman took over. I mean, you think Jay is prepared for that, how much studying he's going to have to do? Or you know, does his background help him out with that, what he's been through, what he's gone through in Denver or whatever?
Well, I think he has to be prepared to study a lot. He's going to get a new playbook, Vaughn. Mm-hmm. You know, this entire offseason, it's not going to be, you know, just walk out in the field for OTAs or spring mini camp and jog around. It's going to be a test every day. That's one thing I did like what Trestman said is the competitive nature of practice and how people will be held accountable in practice. That's the drill with a new coach. You're evaluated every day. Every day is an interview, basically, if you're a veteran on that team, if you want to stick around. So Jay's going to have to really get deep into that playbook because it's going to be new terminology, new alignments, new formations. I think it's going to come off the West Coast offense. There will obviously be variations that Trestman will add to that offense. But at the core of it, it's going to be quick, three-step passing, get the ball out, be accurate with the football. Ball placement will be key. It's going to be a challenging offseason for Jay.
The West Coast idea, while Jay did a version of it, Shanahan's version, which was a good version in Denver, not so much Ron Turner's version, then Mike Martz with a... You know, Martz's playbook has to be bigger than Trestman's. If you survive Martz, you're okay there as far as learning plays, as long as you get your homework in on time and don't get graded down. However, the idea of a West Coast offense, we saw that in the first half against Minnesota when he came back from the concussion and thought he was Joe Montana. The ball got out quick. There weren't a whole lot of yards, but he completed 16 of 18 in the first half, 10 in a row, a touchdown to a tight end, and I think they stopped the game and they sent the ball to Canton. He can do this, be quick, decisive, and accurate, and yet it didn't continue. Is that Cutler's fault? Is that Tice's fault?
You got to look at the offensive coordinator. He's the one who runs the plays. He's the one who calls in the plays. You have to start there. You have to start with the coaching. Obviously, you always wonder how much freedom Jay has at the line of scrimmage to call his own plays, to adjust, to call audibles. But the head coach, the offensive coordinator at that time called in the plays. That's why I'm anxious to see this offense up close when OTA start and when you get down to minicamp and eventually down to Bourbonnais, is to see how fast-paced they are tempo-wise, what type of scheme they're running, and how Jay fits into it. I think he'll be fine. He has the skill set to do it, but he's going to need some work.
Matt, I got to just ask you straight up, put you on the spot. Do you feel that Marc Trestman was the right hire?
I do because he's an offensive guy. That's what you needed. Mm-hmm. I like Coach Arian's scheme. If I'm a player looking at this, I would have loved to play for that Colts team this year, I'll be honest. It looks like they had the ability to deal with adversity, to rally around their interim coach. That was pretty cool. I'll be honest. I would have liked to be a part of that. With Coach Trestman, there's going to be a lot of questions. But he is an offensive guy. He has proven that his scheme works. And it's going to be an adjustment for these players, a new voice in the team meeting room, new set of rules, might have to dress differently on the plane. Who knows? That all changes with a new coach. New meeting times, new practice schedule. It's all this enormous amount of change these veterans that stick around are going to have to go through. But the number one thing is, do they buy into it, Vaughn? That first team meeting is going to be crucial. Guys need to walk out of that team meeting and say, you know what, this is the right guy. You don't want players walking out saying, man, why did we hire this guy? You do not want that, I'll tell you that right now.
All right. Hey, Matt, I appreciate it. Thanks a lot for jumping on with us, and we'll be sure to see you real soon down the road.
All right, guys, thank you.
All right, take it easy. All right, thanks very much to Matt Bowen for sitting in with us. You know, I think it's an interesting thing. Matt leaves us with the thought that, you know, players have to buy in from day one. I have no doubt that among our viewers right now, that included the 53-man roster as it was last constituted, that they were watching today and have some sense of it. And I'm, frankly, if I were a player, and Lord knows I'm not, but that, you know, I would take notice that if he's not gonna give a lot of security, and I didn't hear it, to a guy like Jay Cutler, and I'm not Jay Cutler, that would put me on notice. Oh, I would feel like I heard from the coach there. Nothing that made me feel good that my future is necessarily secure.
Well, we've talked about that from day one. There's going to be significant roster
turnover.
Put
a percentage on it. What percentage?
Boy, it's so hard because here's a factor right here. He didn't rule out the chance of a 3-4.
Yeah.
And if they make that change, there's going to be some significant changes.
No doubt.
There's no doubt about it. So you got to take that in consideration. You got to take age in consideration, I think, with some of these guys.
But your oldest guys are some of your best.
Right. I know that, too. But
you've got a lot of money based.
Yeah. But you
got a lot of money.
But you still have to look at those things. You got to look at, like we talk about with Devin Hester, you know, with his situation. Is he going to be back around? Probably not with the way things are looking right now. So even though the new special teams coach, Joe DeCamillis, said that, hey, he's still one of the most dangerous guys around. And back to what Matt was saying about that you have to believe in this guy when you walk in there. The thing that's going to be tough, though, is I know for a fact there's still guys out there that still believe in Lovie, and they're still hurt by the whole Lovie situation. So it's going to take some convincing from some pretty good players on that team that this is a guy that's going to replace Lovie, because I can tell you right now, some of the guys are thinking, God, they replaced Lovie with a CFL guy? Are you serious? Right. And stuff like that. So
yeah, they can replace you with a CFL guy, too. I mean, that's what it is.
Right.
I've never seen any change where players are playing, changing a coach or a GM, where players right down the list, even the best, were worried about their jobs. And I've seen coaches come in, those with a lot of power, and the willingness and the ability to trade your stars. I've seen that happen. I've seen it be forced. And every player should feel on edge because of that. And they need to feel on edge. They've missed the playoffs 5 of the last 6 years. Why should you feel comfortable? And you may miss Lovie, but whatever defense you played, and Lovie may have been a great guy, Lovie didn't get you to the playoffs 5 of the last 6 years.
No.
One guy I do feel is in somewhat in a comfort zone is Brandon Marshall. I mean, I think that's a piece that he can build around. Even if it's not Jay, you still got a phenomenal receiver out there that's going to get things done. I don't think no matter who the quarterback
Do you think when
they
traded for Brandon Marshall, you would have said this time that the most secure, reliable player they'd have on their roster is Brandon Marshall? All right, on our roster, we expand now. We bring in David Haugh, who is up at Hallis Haugh, and got a chance to...
Did you just call it Hallis Haugh?
In my... sort of weird accent, sometimes it comes out that way. David, are you there on the phone?
I'm here.
Hey, thanks for joining us. I appreciate it. You got a chance to ask some...
great questions.
Great questions. A lot of great questions today. I think you had a few of them. A lot of great questions today. What were your first overall impressions of Trestman with your first extended chance to talk to him?
Well, I think that he's very cerebral, very lawyerly, a guy who definitely came prepared for this moment, no cards and all. I think he was somebody that didn't strike you immediately as a football coach. I think he's a guy that has been waiting for this opportunity for a long time. He's a smart guy. There's no question about it. I don't know that, you know, charisma would not be the word that I would probably, you know, use in my story tomorrow. But I think that he's somebody that put a lot of people on notice because uncertainty is scary. for professional athletes, and I think that there's really not anything that we know about Marc Trestman moving forward beyond the fact that he has a very impressive offensive resume, but we don't know what kind of defense he's going to run. We don't know what he thinks about every receiver other than Brandon Marshall. We don't know how he's going to protect the quarterback, which is a priority to him. And we know that he is not sold on Jay Cutler as a franchise quarterback, or else he would have answered the question directly, because that was a great question by Brad Biggs.
I think you're right. I think you're absolutely right about that. Guys?
Hey, David, I want to ask you this. It's kind of off the subject, but I thought another decent question was when someone asked about the possibility of John Haugh, because I know they wanted to keep somebody from the defense. They wanted to keep the defensive staff in place. There's no doubt about it. I know that. But what about that possibility of a John Haugh? I know that meeting's probably going to go on this afternoon. He's looked at D coordinator positions in the past. I think the Eagles was one of them. You know, he's a Ball State guy. What do you think about that?
Well, that aside, I think he's qualified.
Oh, come on, David. All roads lead back to Muncie. You and I know that.
I know. I'm kidding. He's a great candidate, but they haven't talked yet about that possibility. He's a guy who's going to be one of several in the mix. I just talked to Phil Emery here just inside the lobby, and they're going to consider all people from all different levels, and it's going to be very similar to the Bears head coaching search, and they may end up being looking at college coaches to be the defensive coordinator. John Haugh makes sense because of continuity, but I don't know that that's important now that Rod Marinelli has left the building. I think that, you know, that was part of the interview process, the idea that he would be willing to, you know, stay. But I'm not sure anybody really gauged Rod Marinelli's realistic chances of staying. That may have been maybe one of the flaws of the process, is that if you hire a guy who is open to keeping the old staff, did you talk to the old staff about how open they were to staying? Mm-hmm. So John Haugh is a tremendous candidate. He knows the guys, he knows the system. He has interviewed for jobs in the past, but right now there has been no movement in that direction.
David, I couldn't figure out whether somebody was lying or incapable of I'm not sure what, but when he was talking about, when Marc Trestman was saying, when he was refusing to give essentially scouting reports on what he saw specifically with Bears players or units, because he hadn't seen enough tape, I kept coming back to the question, how did you get the job? What did you and Phil talk about for all that time? Don't you have to tell him how this team, how you're going to make this team win with this talent? So where do you think the truth is in all of that verbal tap dancing?
The truth is that he's not going to reveal anything to the media. I think the truth is that he understands what the Bears have and what they don't have. He's studied, you know, the personnel a lot closer than he revealed publicly and will ever reveal publicly. I think we're dealing with the guy who will be very comfortable keeping information as under lock and key, as well as the general manager did during the whole search process. So this is not going to be, you know, the era of transparency did not dawn today at Haugh Hall. So he knows a lot more than he's letting on, but I think the fact that he was not willing to say anything publicly about strengths or weaknesses probably gives you a glimpse of how he's going to handle, you know, shortcomings of players in the future. This is not going to be a guy that is candid in terms of holding people publicly accountable. Players, they'll probably appreciate that. The media won't, but I don't think we matter up here.
But he said we matter. He said he wanted to retract it from his book. He said we matter.
I didn't read the book yet.
All right, hey, David.
It's being shipped by Amazon.com right now.
When he talked about the offensive line, it's the same as in Canada. We see the same blitzes. We coach the same way.
The box is the same.
The box is the same. Don't tell me it's the same zoo when I know that the claws are sharper in the NFL. They don't have a Clay Matthews Jr. up there. So what did you make of that answer?
Well, you know, Steve, I don't think I would make too much out of it. I think the skepticism over him being in the CFL for the last 5 years is okay. I mean, obviously everyone can have their own opinion. But this guy's NFL experience trumps that. And you got to remember, he was hired as a CFL head coach based on his level of expertise in running NFL offenses. So I know it has been 8 years since he's done that, and that's why I asked him that question. What's changed? Because a lot has changed. But I think that this is a guy that, offensively speaking, the Bears are not going to be behind the rest of the league. I think they're going to be imaginative, innovative, and creative. Three adjectives we'd never use to describe the Lovie Smith offense.
Dave, do you feel that Marc Trestman was number one on Phil Emery's list from the beginning?
After they met, I think, it was definitely something that they have the same birthdays almost. Did you hear that?
So yeah, I thought they were BFFs, and I can't wait to see their Facebook pages.
It was football kismet. So, and I think those were real birthdays. They weren't fake birthdays. But anyway, I think that definitely these are two guys that connected immediately, and I think that once they saw that he became the coach to beat. Bruce Arians made a very, very strong pitch, and I think it made it a little bit more difficult because of the staff he was going to bring in. And, hey, how do you turn down the NFL Coach of the Year? But I think that's how strongly Phil felt about Trestman, and it's going to be a lot of pressure on Trestman. But as I wrote today, there's more pressure on Phil Emery because this is a bold move. There's some high risk involved, and Trestman's got to deliver and make him look good.
Would you think that Jay Cutler was – does he know he was kind of put on notice with Trestman's answer that didn't match the general manager's answer about the franchise quarterback?
Well, I think if he's paying attention, he definitely should take it that way because I think that Trestman was clearly – showed in that answer that he's done his homework and he knows the flaws that exist and the limitations that have been exposed. And Jay Cutler, as a franchise quarterback, we thought he was when he came to Chicago in 2009. So Jay Cutler's on notice, the offensive line's on notice, everybody is on notice. And I'm going to put you guys on notice for one more question if you can because he is breaking up from the group here. Right. And I'd like to try to grab him.
That's all right, David. Go ahead and get out of here. Appreciate your time. We'll see you soon. Thanks, man.
All right, thanks, guys.
Take it easy. You know, one of the things that I was struck by, I think, you know, if you go back to a year ago when Jerry Angelo was dismissed and Ted Phillips said he was going to start the search for a replacement to hire Phil Emery, there were questions about what was the family's involvement going to be, right? Were we going to hear from George McCaskey a lot? Was Virginia McCaskey, who's, you know, the Grand Dam around there, but was she going to be actively involved? I think what we saw in that process was they found Phil Emery and they said, okay, go be a GM. Now, go be a GM a year after you were able to finally pick your coach, but then now go be a GM. And he expressed this morning at his introductory conference that he reminded the world that George said, when it's time to defer, it's your choice. And so he made his choice and he's hired his coach. And now where there is some disagreement between the head coach and the GM about what is the franchise status of the quarterback, it sounds like the coach is going to be able to pick his staff and make his decisions. And what through all of that process, it sounds like what the Bears have finally done has become a modern corporate style, officially run NFL franchise where you hire somebody to do their job and they go do their job. Now that does not mean necessarily that it's going to work. It doesn't mean that the Bears are going to go win the Super Bowl in a couple of years. It doesn't mean Jay Cutler is going to turn into a franchise quarterback. It doesn't mean any of that stuff. But at least it means that sort of the meddling and the process and stuff seem like it's being cleaned up. That there is some, that you can count some on Phil Emery. You can count some now on Marc Trestman, and we'll see how he puts together his staff. And these people will sort of succeed or fail on their own merits of how they do their job. And if nothing else, that is progress for Haugh.
No, I agree with you to a point. But I do feel that Phil Emery kind of has still that control there. I mean, I'm looking.
Maybe, but you can see where they'd have an affinity for each other. Right. They look like sort of the same guy just a few years ago.
Right, but I'm looking, say Bruce Arians.
Right, okay.
He looks like a guy that I thought would come in here and kind of put his foot down and be the guy and be like, hey, you know, what I say goes. Trestman seems like a guy like, hey, I'm going to go to Phil first. And it just seems like that initially. I'm not saying that that's how it's going
to
work
out. The guy's first day and he's talking to the media. I think he's going to defer to the GM who just gave him the job.
Well, no. I understand what you're saying, but I'm saying looking in even before this press conference, I saw that. I saw Arians as a guy that I thought would have come in here and just really been like put his foot down and, hey, I'm in control and stuff like that, where I thought that, you know, maybe Trestman wasn't going to be that guy, but we'll see. We'll see how it
comes. Trestman was Robert Hoover, the chapter chairman.
Here we go.
Appearing before Dean Wormer.
All right.
And I really thought that Arians might have been more like Bluto, maybe like D-Day. I thought he would have been a lot more fun. I thought he would have been, he would have filled up the room. He would have, he's at an age, and he's got the experience, and he's got the accomplishments, that he would have been a lot more fun and a lot more I don't care. Trestman's really thrilled to have this job. And we tell by Emery, we were talking about it when he was really yucking it up.
He
was feeling
total
it.
Handball,
he got his guy. Yeah. He's done. We're off and running. And I got to say, I'm in favor of that. I like that more than when I saw, like, Ted Phillips and Lovey and Jerry give each other back slaps and raises and whatever. I'm happy to see that an offensive coach was involved the optimism and some of the blue sky stuff that he's looking at. The offense, we want to score touchdowns. It couldn't be plainer than that. That's what Trestman said.
Right.
I'm happy to see that. I'm happy to hear that.
Right. I'm also happy to see that, you know, his philosophy also can boil down to protect the quarterback and get the quarterback. Protect the ball and get the ball. It seems pretty simple.
They're going to win the line of scrimmage. That's what he says. They're going to win.
And I think they got the young guys, no matter who the defensive coordinator is or who's coaching the defensive line. And Marinelli was a lot of both.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Julius Peppers is still the first guy you'd game plan around in that defense. Mm-hmm. After that, on the defensive line, there's suddenly guys, and I thought Henry Melton's, if he's a Pro Bowler, it's a weak year for defensive tackles at Pro Bowl, but he was improving, and Corey Wooten was improving, and you were seeing Adonijé play inside and out and making plays. Suddenly you're seeing Shea McClellan was showing up more regularly near the end.
But that's who we want to see. I mean, because that's Emery's guy. That's his first guy. That's the guy you want to see make the biggest leap next year. Because if he doesn't make that leap, then people are questioning, hey, you know, what's going on here?
Right. And I'm with you on that. Mm-hmm. I would hope that Emery doesn't draft a guy who missed a year because of injury, because of a broken collarbone. Right. I don't need any more guys who come pre-injured the way Brandon Harden did, especially when they needed safeties.
Right.
But you're looking at that defense, and there are, while the age is the best part of it, there are some guys who are growing up into their positions, and it starts on the defensive line. That's a lot stronger than what you see in the offensive line, especially with Lance Lewis hurt.
Right.
He was their best.
Right.
And he's a good young offensive lineman. But at least if you're talking about getting to the quarterback, they got depth to do that.
And as far as the offensive line, I know for a fact that the Bears were extremely impressed with the two tackles for Texas A&M who blocked for Johnny Football. But I believe one of them stayed, and one of them is probably going to be the first guy off the board. So, you know,
if the Alabama guy doesn't beat him there, that was an NFL offensive line too. Right.
Well, it's interesting you mention that. So one of the goals that Phil Emery, when he fired Lovie Smith, he said he wanted to have his coach in position to stand alongside him at the All-Star games and other scouting combines, and he'll have that. We have the conference championship games, everyone knows, is Sunday. Then we go into Senior Bowl next week in Alabama. And then we have the Pro Bowl, Super Bowl, and then the NFL combine. All of that plus free agency to come before April's draft. So these guys sound like they want to get fast to work. They still need to hire some coaches who can then evaluate the roster, then figure out what they want to do. So they still have some work to do. But all of those dates, all those important, you know, Texas A&M offensive tackles, we're going to know all about them. And they sound like they're going to get started right away.
Yeah, definitely. The one thing I am kind of interested in, just kind of curious, he did talk about bringing some people from Montreal.
Right.
I'm curious to know who those coaches will be.
There may be some NFL expats up there, too.
Right. I'm not sure. I don't know who their defensive coordinator was up there. I don't know if that would be a guide. I would think that he'd look NFL-wise for a defensive coordinator because of the premium of that position and stuff like that. So we'll see. We'll see how that unfolds, too.
Right. I like the idea that after what we saw and all the wasted timeouts, that the head coach who will be calling plays had to work with a 20-second clock. That they had in Canada, in the CFL, if you don't know, they had to get plays in within 20 seconds. Right. They had to run them. I'm sorry, not get them in. The Bears couldn't get them in within 20 seconds.
Right.
So
that, when he talked about the tempo of an offense, mm-hmm. when you saw what New England did last weekend to a Houston team, to a Houston defense that destroyed the Bears, mm-hmm. gave them nothing, asphyxiated them, gave them nothing, and Tom Brady just picked it apart, pantsed it. They were up, they were running, they were moving, they were playing with pace. And I know that it's Tom Brady and you trust him and everybody does. That was the hearing tempo and hearing pace and knowing it has to be done quick in the CFL should encourage Bears fans. Mm-hmm. That if that's one of the things he brings down, besides the smoked meat from Schwartz's Deli, which I would encourage.
Yes,
then you won't see Jay getting all mad and calling timeout.
And that's another thing about the West Coast offense. It's all about pace, timing. And I go back to the Minnesota game. I don't remember any performance looking more like Montana or Steve Young or even Cutler going back to Denver. Quick, get it in, throw it, find it. Now, he is a pick it, stick it guy. Right. See it, throw it. But he was doing a wonderful job of making good decisions and making quick decisions. Mm-hmm. And you've seen him run around. You're going, wow. And he contributes to his own sacks. Mm-hmm. And guess what? You don't need a great offensive line. If that's the offense you're running, you don't need to protect for 7 seconds.
Mm. So. Right. But they need some linemen.
Yeah, I think you're right. All right, guys, any final thoughts here? I think we're going to let our viewers get back to their lunch and the rest of their days.
I just want to say I think you're a franchise sports editor.
Thanks, man.
If he could suck up, then I could suck up. If that's the corporate way to do it.
I appreciate it. Thank you, Steve Rosenbloom, for joining us. Thank you, Von McClure, for joining us. Thank you to Matt Bowen and David Haugh for calling in. A few closing thoughts. Trestman talked today about excellence and commitment to win and tough football and disciplined football and the science of the game. I think we have a lot more to see out of this new coaching staff, a lot more to see out of Trestman, who he hires, who he brings in, how it changes the roster. It's going to be a very interesting next couple of months. Hard to believe we're still, 8 or 9 months away from the start of the season. I think they'll be ready. Hopefully they'll be ready. Mm-hmm. We were ready today. Thank you very much for joining us. Appreciate it. Thank you for your time. And we'll see you the next time we try this out. Take it easy.